We hear the scripture text this morning from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 7, beginning in verse 24. I invite you now to hear the reading of the Word of God as we hear it from Mark, not Matthew. There's another pericope similar there, but it's from Mark, chapter 7. From there, Jesus set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there. He could not escape notice, but a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin, and she begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home and found the child lying on the bed, the demon gone. The word of God for the people of God. Let's pray. Lord, we are your people. And we long to be more so. In these few precious moments, we pray that your Spirit would do the work that only your Spirit can. That you would call within us a deep desire to engage with the living Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Can you hear me through the system?
Yes.
Okay, I'm not going to yell. So this text has been a conundrum of a text in all 12 years of ministry that I have preached. I remember the first time that I got to preach upon the story of the Syrophoenician woman. There was a whole lot of conversation that was happening between me and a seminary friend of mine. It was my second year of ministry, and we both preached the sermon on this text, and we came together every week. And we must have debated for an hour on what we each said. And by the time I was done, I was both more confused and I was more enlightened than I had been just 48 hours earlier when I had attempted to share a word from the Lord. Same text, but after debating, after talking with, after seeing through the eyes of another, after hearing from someone else's experience and understanding, even though it was the same words on the page, the living Word of God somehow speaks differently. Isn't it amazing how that can happen? And so we look at this text and we wonder what is going on. I was talking to my 7-year-old and my 9-year-old at the dinner table last night. I already knew what the sermon was about, but I wanted to engage them. So I said, "Drew, the 7-year-old, I want to tell you a story. I need your help." He goes, "All right, what you need help with, Mom?" I said, "Well, there's this sermon that I have to preach tomorrow." He goes, "What do you need help with, Mama?" I said, "Let me tell you the story, buddy. Jesus was needing a break. And so he walked away from his homeland, and he went over to, let's call it, the beach, the seacoast, Tyre. It was on the coast. But it was not his land. It was the land of the other people. So he walked into a different country, if you will, and it wasn't a Jewish country. So it was somebody with a different religion from a different country. And when he walked into a house, a woman came up to him and said, "Jesus, can you heal my daughter?" Drew goes, "Okay, that sounds rough, right?" He said, "Okay, but Jesus told the woman, we give the bread to the kids first, not to the dogs." Drew goes, "Now you lost me." So it gets even better. The woman's response says, "Even the dogs get to eat the crumbs that the kids drop from the table." Drew goes, "I thought we were talking about a sick girl. How do we get to dogs and the crumbs under the table?" That's an excellent question, bud. Because then the woman is told for saying that. started exploring an understanding of what it could be to go down with humility before Christ brings us up and heals us. Not the sermon I was going to preach, but interesting how different lenses and eyes can see the same text. So we see the Syrophoenician woman, and we understand that it makes absolutely no sense what Jesus is saying, because we know Jesus, right? Jesus loves, Jesus is good, Jesus is kind, Jesus wants to cast a wide net, Jesus is here for all, Jesus is the one who calls us at the end of Matthew to go into the ends of the earth, beginning in Jerusalem, then to Judea and Samaria, then to all the ends of the world. And I want you to teach, and I want you to baptize in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. All that you witness, Jesus gets it as the Son of God. But why would the Jesus who is all of that turn to a woman who is a different ethnicity and not the right religion and compare her and her people to dogs? Well, if somebody were to put it in colloquial language, we might think that it was an awful word, a cursed word, if you will, but that's not where Jesus was going. While this may sound insulting, I wonder if there's something deeper happening. Engagement at another level. I spent Thursday and Friday with a group of pastors and a pastor in our conference who works at many levels of spiritual growth and formation and conflict resolution, Craig Bielam. He's like the Yoda of Louisiana. And we were talking about the power of engagement. Now, I'm not talking about the ring and the proposal. I'm talking about in the business world. In the world of systems and organizations, you've got people that spend a majority of their time working. And those same people that show up to work every day can approach, and this may sound a little simplistic, so forgive the simplicity, but can approach in three ways. They can come as those who are actively engaged, passionate, understanding the purpose of the system that they serve, and knowing that they are an important part of making that purpose happen, actively engaged. They can come as not actively engaged, more of a disinterested engagement. It's showing up for work, and it's looking at the list of things to do, punching the time clock, checking off the list, and punching out. I'm sure we've all had days where we've shown up and we've just got the job done. Because life happens. And then there are those who are actively disengaged. Actively disengaged. They're the ones that can be toxic for the system. The ones who, through bad habits of behavior, can sabotage the way that the system operates. We show up as one of those three regularly. What surprised me was not the definition of the three. What surprised me was the percentage of people in the world that show up actively engaged. It was somewhere between 20 and 30%. Could you imagine spending your life punching a time clock, or even worse, not excited to the point of you want to destroy in some form or fashion the system that you work for because you don't believe in its purpose? 20 to 30% actively engaged. In the United States, it was a little bit better. We were around 40%. Still, low percentages. And so we were looking at this tool, this questionnaire, 12 questions that the Gallup Institute, through Clifton StrengthsFinders analysis, has started going through with companies. 12 questions that supervisors can ask employees that can measure that kind of engagement. And almost every one of the questions, except for the first two, hit on our value as a person. The first two questions were like Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Do you have what you need in order to be able to do the job? And do you know what the job is? I mean, we gotta have some basics, right? But once we get past the basics, it's questions like, at work, do you have the opportunity to do what you do best, at least once a day? Does someone at work or your supervisor seem to care about you as a person? Is there someone at work who encourages your development? Do your opinions seem to count? Does the mission or the purpose of your company make you feel like your job is important? And it goes on and on with more questions. What's at the heart of engagement is that we are a people of relationship. That's truly what's written all over this page of notes that I took. We are a people who find purpose in what we believe in, but purpose in what we believe in is not enough to keep us passionately engaged in the day-to-day, mundane, showing up and getting the job done. But when we are connected, when we see each other as people of value, and when we are seen as people of value, then we begin to understand that we live in to a bigger purpose, a greater purpose, a purpose beyond us, something like discipleship, engagement. Well, if relationship between one another is that critical, what is a relationship with Jesus worth? Because at the very heart of Christianity is one who longs to go deeper and deeper in relationship with the Lord. All of the vows that we make when we join the church, much less this fellowship of the United Methodist Church, vows to pray, vows to show up, to be present with our whole selves, vows to serve, vows to give sacrificially to the Lord through our tithes, and then above and beyond with any offering that we want to give, that we've been blessed to offer, vows to witness. Those are measures of discipleship. But all of those are tools, as we talked about a couple of months ago, to help us understand our relationship with God better. We don't live into them selfishly because they're all about reaching out to others, but at the same time, if we don't have them, we're not growing. And y'all, our point as people here in this place is to grow as disciples who are open and willing to be used by the Lord to possibly make other disciples. That's not my job as pastor. It's my job as Christian. And it's not my job as pastor. It's our job as disciples of Jesus Christ. What does any of that have to do with the Syrophoenician woman? I'm glad you asked. This woman was a Gentile. She was not of the right country. And she was a woman. Three strikes, she's out. She should have known better than to approach a man who was not her husband or her father or her brother, a man who was not her family. She could have been dismissed in what we would consider horribly inhumane ways. But she boldly steps out. There's some sort of trust. Now, maybe she heard of this healer, but Jesus hadn't really stepped out of the area of the Jews up until this point. And so it could be that rumor had preceded him, or it could be that the Holy Spirit spoke to this woman who is unnamed, but is defined as a mother first and as a stranger and a foreigner second. It could be that this woman had the Holy Spirit open her eyes just as Peter's heart was strangely warmed when Jesus called him by name and said, "Get out of the boat. I'm going to teach you how to fish differently." An encounter with Jesus sometimes is inexplicable, but it's an encounter that changes your life. So she sees him, and somehow she trusts that she can approach him. Can you imagine? We've been taught today that we can go to God in prayer about anything, sometimes to the point where we take it for granted, but can you imagine? Put yourself in the shoes of this woman for one moment, and imagine the courage it took to cry out to him, "Heal my daughter." What wouldn't we do for our children? What wouldn't we do for those that we love? What risk would we not be willing to take? And as she reaches out in risk for the sake of love, as she's willing to sacrifice herself and her pride, on the page. But the fact that he looked and he spoke to her shows a huge amount of respect and invitation at a time when culture would not have expected him to do that. And then when he speaks to her, when he engages with her, he speaks to her in a way that the rabbis spoke to one another. It was called sparring. It's kind of like the back and forth that athletes do when they're trying to get stronger. You know, football players, they blow the whistle and then they tackle one another until one of them pushes out. I never played football, but I hear that's what happens. We used to spar in fencing. Looked like we didn't like each other at all, but what we were actually doing was helping one another hone our skills. Scripture tells us, steel sharpens steel, iron sharpens iron. And I upped it a notch when our boys were little and they were just discovering how much they loved to fight, to push my buttons. And I would say, as iron sharpens iron, brother sharpens brother. He looked and he engaged and he spoke, and he spoke in an intellectual way that honored her as a person of worth. But you can't spar one-sided. It takes two people, right? So she reaches out in trust and in faith with great boldness and great courage. He receives the trust and he engages in conversation. What did he say? He said, it's not right to give bread to the dogs. You gotta give it to the kids first. What did he mean by that? You see, in this period of time when Mark is being written, Jesus' time, and then a couple of decades later as the Gospels were being written down, there was great socioeconomic tension between the people of Tyre and the people of Galilee, the Gentiles and the Jews. A lot of the agricultural things that were produced, the bread, the grain, that should have gone on to the tables of the children of Galilee was ending up in the markets at Tyre because that's where the money was. So the people known as the Jews in Jesus' hometown were going hungry because of the wealth of the Gentiles. And now she wants my help. He could have made a point. In this moment, she represents a people who are the enemy. Not just a people that aren't like us, we're higher than you, don't you know the hierarchical order of things? We're God's favored. No, she represents an enemy. An enemy who's the scum of the enemy because she's a she. An enemy who's the scum of the enemy because she's all the wrong things. This would have been the moment for Jesus to use his power and his authority to show the disciples how to put someone in their place. But instead he engages with her in conversation by speaking a truth that is hard to hear. She would have understood what he was talking about. Yeah, you're right, Jesus. My people have done wrong to you. Notice she didn't get all fired up. She didn't get on Facebook and start doing all the weird emojis that sometimes we do. She stuck with the metaphor and said, but even the dogs. She was willing to put herself in the category of humility for the sake of showing him that she was engaged, that she heard what he was saying, that she understood, and that she believed more could be possible. I don't think the Syrophoenician Gentile mother knew that there would one day be something called a theology of abundance and a theology of scarcity. I think she lived in a world where there were limited resources, and when there are limited resources, competition breeds socioeconomic tension and hatred, and yes, even what was known as the Jewish War that killed thousands of people. When all of that happens over basic essentials like grain and bread, to believe in the possibility possibility of abundance, to believe that even though God has given all of the bread to the children first, a crumb can still be present. And that crumb, that's all I need. What faith. What hope. Instead of it being either or, up or down, top or bottom, first or last, right or wrong, she was willing to see that maybe it's a both and. Maybe God has some greater resources available than we could ever begin to imagine. Maybe she understood the concept of grace before she ever learned the vocabulary. And Jesus, when he heard her response, said, "Because you said that. Because you engaged. Because you meant what you said. Because you heard with humility and not with hostility. Because you're willing to believe that all things are possible for God. Because you have the faith of a mustard seed, oh no, of a crumb. Your daughter's healed. Go home. Check it out." And she did. And the daughter was. It's an amazing thing what happens when we grow in relationship, when we grow with engagement, when we have hard and honest conversations that are both truth-filled and offered in love. Open spaces that we create in our hearts to allow for God to continue to inform us and reform us and transform us time and time again, every time we approach the living Word of God. It has the opportunity to transform us once more. And we're in a season, as we always are, where, once again, there are arguments that are loud all around us, right and wrong, top and bottom, first and last, right side of the wall, wrong side of the wall. We create hierarchies because it helps us feel like we have some measure of control and some measure of security and comfort. What wouldn't we do if the person who was on the bottom, who was at the last, who was on the other side of the wall, who was just coming out of prison, who didn't smell quite right because they hadn't had a shower in a few days, what would we do if that was our child? How would we respond differently if we engaged with them deeply? Jesus calls us brothers and sisters. God calls us sons and daughters. So whether we like it or not, when we call ourselves Christians, we are related. And as those who are brothers and sisters in Christ, we are called to engage with one another. And we can't do that if we continue to live lives that are siloed. Our neighbor or even our not so neighbor, do that? That's the question. Amen? Lord, we praise your name because we know that there are days when we are simply a mess. There are days when we accidentally stumble into getting something right for you. And then there are those few precious moments where we know what we want to do and we know what we need to do and we hear your voice and we actually find the courage to see it through. God, in the moments of our messiness, forgive us and call us forth into a way that walks with your Spirit. In the moments of stumbling through and accidentally getting it right, God, call us to a way of discipleship that is more intentional, intentionally growing that Spirit within us and intentionally reaching out to help others in their journey. And God, for those precious moments when everything lines up, we get it right with purpose. May we raise our hands in praise and say thank you to the God who gives all goodness and grace. Help us, Lord, even in our moments.